Well, I guess right now the floor is open for general discussion. So if you have any questions for any of the speakers in this session, this is the time to ask. I know there are some people want to ask questions.
I have a question for Mike about you have showed a slide in the, about the oxycarbazepine. It seems because the structure is similar to carbazepine, so people are always thinking about whether the genetic link is to the B-phenyl-2 have a similar reaction, similar link. And my question is because by clinical observation, the incidence, even in Asian countries, incidence is quite low. Although the drug structure is similar, and also the severity is also low. So consider the genetic test, the cause effectiveness. I would like to know how the FDA consider that.
Could you, I'm sorry, how FDA considers,
To label if the, I know the B-phenyl-2 have been labeled for oxycarbazepine in Europe, European country, also in Taiwan, but I don't know whether how the FDA to think it, how it's possible to label B-phenyl-2 for oxycarbazepine is like a,
ask Sally to comment, but I would just say that, I mean, we can't really speak about sort of specific labeling considerations necessarily, but, you know, the principle would apply that if you have sufficient suspicion that, you know, one drug in class causes an event and you can predict it and identify patients who are likely to have toxic response, that you would use any available information to help inform other similarly compounds that have similar liabilities. Now, we can't necessarily label or restrict use based on theoretical concerns. So, you know, there does have to be some obvious risk that's been detected.
Yeah, I don't have anything to add.
This is also for Mike. You had mentioned at the conclusion of your talk about the FDA having some desire to potentially utilize clinical decision support to help with the avoidance of these severe adverse events. This may be an unfair question because I suspect it's in another portion of this large agency that you don't necessarily touch, but FDA has expressed opinion that they have the ability to regulate clinical decision support as a device because of concerns about safety. And so my question is, do you see that as inherently in conflict, or is this a way that we could potentially move forward to try and get through this potential minefield of problems relating to the device perception of the FDA?
Yeah, I think that is managed by the Center for Devices, and I'm from the Center for Drugs, so. the spirit of that comment was more that, you know, FDA labeling as a communication tool to inform prescribing is not the most agile. And I think that there probably is some value in having dynamic clinical decision support systems that would be able to inform prescribing in a real-time basis based on accumulating evidence, even if imperfect. Because the other systems aren't necessarily going to be able to react so quickly. That was the nature of that comment. We work with devices a lot. if I may actually just follow up to that point. I mean, there has been interest with all of the next generation sequencing talk as evidenced in previous workshops that there is an intense amount of interest in trying to figure out other ways to communicate clinical validity and have that be established that's outside of FDA walls.
There's been very little said about African Americans or Africans and the risk for these complications, but as far as in liver disease, African Americans are overrepresented when it comes to liver injury from allopurinol and the aromatic anticonvulsants. Do we have any idea of the rates of Stevens-Johnson syndrome in blacks?
Yeah, this is an issue we looked at many years ago. One of the problems in the literature was that cases kept being re-reported and accumulated. So when somebody said, oh, there were so many thousand cases, it was, you know, the same cases kept being reported over and over again. So we looked at it in Toronto with the people that we were studying, and we looked at it and compared it to the census data, which was about a year old at the time. And there did not appear to be a strong signal. It might be, for the anti-epileptics, it looked like it might be twice as high as in the white population. But then there was a paper around the same time that said that epilepsy was probably twice as prevalent in a black population. So I don't know what that means. However, I would say that when blacks have had Stevens-Johnson TN, they would have perhaps more severe disease and worse outcomes. And part of that might well be the recognition of the rash early on. People have maybe tender skin, itchy skin, the rash isn't picked up. That's my concern. And that extra delay of even 3 days or 4 days, whether it's access to healthcare or good diagnosis, could result in worse outcomes from higher mortality rates and higher morbidity, for sure. So I think it's a very important but potentially a loaded question in trying to figure out exactly all that's going on. But there's others who are going to comment on it as well.
So it goes to the issue of FDA labeling. If you say for Asians that it's worthwhile screening for this, the problem is this whole problem, we don't have data. It's not like the data is negative. We don't know. How do we deal with that?
I mean, we try to communicate that uncertainty to the best of our ability. I mean, it was a little unsettling to hear that there's a genetic predictor in Italians and not the rest of Europe, and I shudder to think how you could write something around that. You know, so there is uncertainty. And I think for a lot of adverse reactions and pharmacogenetic biomarkers that, you know, if there is a absence of an effect, that's often stated. If there's uncertainty about what the implications of it are, that will also be communicated.
Well, we certainly know the rates of these HLA types in African Americans. Are they overrepresented?
Some of them are. I mean,
5801 is pretty much represented across races, although it's most prevalent in Southeast Asians. It is represented in blacks and Caucasians, and the same with 1502, but 5701 obviously is much lower in blacks. And, you know, when you look at African Americans, obviously you're looking at admixture, so you have to take into account admixture, so the prevalence, the carriage rate, is going to be somewhat intermediate, and we saw that obviously with 5701, where it's less than 1% in Africans, continental Africans, but 2-3% in African Americans. And, you know, unfortunately, the actual true prevalence rates haven't been worked out in terms of actually there's continuing admixture. So it's a bit of a moving target. I mean, clearly there's admixture continuing in the United States. So some of these things, I think, need to be reevaluated over time.
It's the same with what we call Hispanics, which is a diverse racial mix. You know, the Mexican Americans are different than like Cuban Americans and might more represent native peoples, the genes of native peoples. So these types of things would be very, I think, very important to look at, the rates of these alleles in different populations. And can you say for sure that the risk of these severe adverse reactions is different in different races independent of the allele?
Elizabeth, microphone.
It's a clue that we should be looking. If you see actually, the initial clues that actually led to looking for HLA associations with drugs to begin with actually were that there was an overrepresentation in specific racial groups. So it goes both ways. If there's actual epidemiological evidence that there's a clear clue that there's a racial preponderance, and that is actually an important clue to actually look first for an HLA association. And the other issue that Manir was talking about yesterday with nevirapine and C401, that is an allele that's well represented across races, although there still may be other metabolic factors in certain racial groups like blacks, where there is actually a heightened risk because of that, for instance. So there's complex effects. And the phenytoin CYP2C9 star 3 issue in Southeast Asians is another example where you're not just looking at an HLA association, there's complex effects. But when you see a strong independent epidemiological effect, I would say that's actually a strong indication in an immunologically mediated drug reaction that it is almost going to be a pure HLA effect.
So obviously, ethnicity is a very important issue in this. So can we have Maya to comment on this?
Actually, my point was what Neil said, what they observed in the black population and what you asked. When we did a study, part of our epidemiological study in Europe was to look for certain exposures, and when we compared the people with SJSTN exposed to nevirapine, it turned out that most of them were of African ancestry in different countries, but mainly in France. So when we compared this group of nevirapine-induced SJSTN patients to all other patients, the severity of the disease was about the same. The outcome was about the same. So this is not black and white comparison, but it is among these nevirapine HIV-infected patients, the majority were Africans. So what I was saying is we couldn't see that the severity of the disease was higher, and we didn't see a higher death rate, but the HIV-infected patients are usually younger than the other ones we have, and we know that age is one of the factors for a higher death rate. So just to put this a little bit into perspective.
I just want to ask a question on the drug-induced liver injury. We're also collecting samples for the anti-TB drug-induced liver injury. And because it's a cocktail, and when I asked the doctors, you know, what do you do when you actually found a liver injury, the answer is never the same, because the causative agent can be any of the, you know, four main items in the cocktail. All this while we thought it was isoniazid, and then I think Thailand reported that it's more, or was it Rika in Indonesia that said that it's probably more ethambutol. So, you know, I was wondering, with all these uncertainties, that would actually prolong the treatment that is required and for the anti-TB part. So perhaps I'd like a comment from you. Because I think what we're trying to do, the Southeast Asian group, is actually get all our cases together and do this as a project. At the moment, it's actually individual. Comments, please.
Yeah, I'm sorry, I didn't understand the question.
Perhaps you could talk about it during lunch, because we do have to move on. We have a couple of more questions.
Put your microphone up.
Last comment.
Sorry. Did you switch me off, did you? A comment, first of all. I was involved in the working party that changed the label with the European Medicines Agency for carbamazepine in 1502, and the longest time of discussion that we had was, how do you define an Asian? How do you define a Southeast Asian? And obviously we're coming to, how do you define a Caucasian, et cetera. And I think that is a big challenge as we go deeper into genomics that is facing all of us and the regulators in particular. And I think there needs to be some harmonization across the different regulatory agencies in terms of how that is done and how that's defined, because you'll see that the European label, in terms of how it defines with 1502, is completely different from the FDA label. So I think it is important that maybe the International Conference of Harmonization might be an avenue where people need to sit down and talk about how they're going to actually start defining this within drug labels. That's a comment. Question for Mike. So let me just put in a disclaimer first. As a senior author on the New England Journal of Medicine 3101 paper, and you compared and contrasted the 1502 and 3101, And 3101 does lead to, is I completely agree that the effect size is less than with 1502, and it does lead to a wide variety of adverse effects, some which are mild, but some which are also very serious, including DRESS, you know, where it's been replicated in many different ethnic populations in the, I'm going to use the terms again, Caucasians, Asians, Chinese, Han Chinese, etc. So with so much replication, what evidence do you need to be able to make the label more sort of mandatory rather than information only? Do you need a prospective study? Do you need a prospective trial? What would you need to be able to change the label from what it is to be consistent with what's seen with the 1502?
It's complicated to answer. I mean, there's probably no, I mean, the evidence is there. The effect size is smaller, and the efficiency of screening in terms of true positives that you're going to get in terms of positive predictive value, negative predictive value are likely going to shift quite a bit. You know, whether there's some odds ratio threshold that you cross that you make some more affirmative recommendation, that's not been defined. So it's hard to say. I don't. If you have suggestions.
No, I agree. It is difficult to say, but you know, Matt may want to comment on this, and Matt did some power calculation, but you would need a huge prospective study to be able to get the same precision of estimates that can be seen with the case control studies that are already available. And my worry is that sometimes we have a different level of evidence needs for genetic markers compared to other markers. So if you had, let's say, serum rhubarb, which said that it predisposes to carbamazepine hypersensitivity, because serum rhubarb might be easily measured in a laboratory and everybody knows about that test, it might be easier to get that into the label than to get a genetic test marker. And that is a worry, and that you can see that genetic exceptionalism everywhere within medicine.
Yeah, I mean, there is that exceptionalism, and I'm not sure why it exists. I think if you can make some risk assessment for an individual patient based on age and race, you should do just the same for genetics, but the reality is right now we don't necessarily have all that information, and there is a societal burden of imposing testing on costs and all of the other things. We also don't necessarily dictate medical practice absent contraindications and indications. The professional societies may have a say in this as well. I'm CPIC, I'm not sure.
So any questions, not for Mark?
leave for Mike alone.
I'll just answer, I do not know. No.
Question for Mary Carrington, because what's the best technology now and cheapest to just do the HLA type for an individual? Because if we can just do it once and then the patient knows it for allopurinol and carbamazepine and abacavir and then all the other risks that you mentioned for disease, maybe that's the most efficient use of our healthcare dollars.
The big problem is that it's actually, in our lab, we can do ABC, DRD, QDP for $80. The problem is that when we do that, we're doing nearly 400 people at a time. So the real issue here is trying to come up with an inexpensive way of typing one individual very quickly, and that's what you need. And I would say, what I'm saying is it's much more cost effective to do a whole lot of people at once than it is one person every day for 5 months or something. And so there are kits that can be purchased, and they are meant for typing, and I think they're from Dynol. They can be purchased, and they are meant for typing a single individual at a time, and I think a lot of transplant labs use those. They're not hugely inexpensive, but I don't think they're outrageous. I actually don't know how much they cost. But they're quick, and they'll do one person at a time. They might not be huge resolution, but it doesn't sound to me that that's really what you need.
Maybe I could follow up if you don't mind with Mary on that question. I think Alan raised a very insightful question about how about looking at all of the variation. I mean, as variable a region as that is, it's hard to imagine that all of the types that are known possibly encompass all of the variation that could be there. So is there work going on to identify more serotypes, or is it that humans are a young population and so really we don't have all of the variants there?
You know, there. Somebody mentioned this. Maybe it was Elizabeth, that at the B locus there are over 5,000 alleles. Okay, so and there will be more alleles. Most of those, the vast majority of those, are hugely rare. The problem is that all of the techniques that we've used historically, they keep the rare ones rare, because they make the assumption. Oh, this! I've got this sequence. I don't have sequence from exon 4, and the most common one is, you know, 1502. So it must be a 1502, and that keeps the rare ones really rare. But now, deep sequencing is used routinely for HLA typing. You know, there is like the ABI junior could be used to sequence a single individual. And I don't really know the cost. I could look into what those kind of costs are. Maybe you know, Elizabeth. But and that gives really high resolution data. But I think right now what I would do is look at what the transplant labs are doing. They're getting high enough resolution that, you know, they can go ahead and do a transplant, and they're using, you know, techniques that are the least expensive. And, you know, there are a lot of techniques, you know, we used to use sequence-specific primers, and it was a really inexpensive way to do it. You need a good bit of DNA, but I don't think that would be a problem here. It's inexpensive. You do one person at a time. There are things, so, and that's basically what that Dynol kit is as well. So if it was useful, I could try to generate, identify information on that and the cost for doing different types, which, you know, a lot of people, I don't know if there's somebody here from a transplant lab that could comment.
Is it one of our clinical center colleagues here who does the transplant typing? Or maybe
I might just make a comment that research labs that have high throughput, I mean, our lab, for instance, has both research and clinical accreditation. But as Mary said, it's the high throughput nature of it that gets it down to reagents costs. And with reagent costs, you can get things down to $50 to $70 a sample for sure. But at the end of the day, even if you have all the alleles available to you, you're still left with the decision support aspect of things and getting a report. The other caveat is that it really is important to have quality labs doing this and labs that actually have quality assurance programs. I mean, we saw this early in the back of your story that once the clinical story and the association had been worked out, that all the safety issues moved to the lab. And there were episodes of false positives and false negatives for 5701. There were blacks in the UK being called as 5701 positive when they were negative. And there were a smattering of cases that were safety issues where they were false negative for 5701 in the early days. So it really is important to get the lab technology right. And the final sort of point I'll make is really there's other sort of innovative techniques. Flow cytometry should not be overlooked. There's actually a lab in San Francisco, I think Alan Wu is doing HLA B57 by B17. Using a B17, I think it's a 1-lambda antibody, but because B58 is part of that same serotype, he could actually effectively, if he had QA'd it for this, screen for both allopurinol and abacavir with that B17 antibody. So there are other innovative ways of doing this, but I would still at the end of the day say if you ended up with information on 5,000 you know, across the population on different HLA alleles, how would, what information would you provide to patients? That's the problem.
Two final comments.
I think the HLA testing is actually done in my laboratory at the NIH Clinical Center Department of Transfusion Medicine. And we looked into that very carefully. We did the pharmacogenomics for HLA in the clinical center program. It's not that cheap. And one has to do it at a clinical approved level to make a clinical decision. That's different from simply doing research and doing screening. That can be done relatively inexpensively, but once you actually want to make a clinical decision, it does cost some money, and particularly in the United States. And one has to consider that big issue, and perhaps one could contribute something to that, is forwarding the information. You know, you have to do it only once in a lifetime if the documentation is properly maintained and can be used decades from now. And we perceived a lack of infrastructure to have this documentation in place. And perhaps a cost-efficient aspect would be to get a good documentation of what is done or can be done today. Typically, one would probably look for sequencing results at this time, which is expensive. It's not $80. But it's worthwhile longer term to do it at the sequence level and also identify rare alleles which otherwise would be missed if you do it inexpensively.
Thank you. Last comment.
I can give you an actual cost. I mean, the immunology lab at the hospital where I work to do MHC1 and MHC2 is $400. I can also tell you this, you need to be very careful about discussing costs because often people are discussing reagent costs. So it's costing them $40 for the reagents, but then it may be costing them another $200 for the manpower or person power. So to say the test only costs $40 isn't a real reflection of the economics of the test.
Okay, I think we just stop here. And unfortunately, this is a great session. I would like to thank all the speakers and all the comments and questions. And next time, we should have more time for questions, I think.
Well, the way we get more time for questions is the speakers stay to their times. So so that was a challenge. But thank you, and thank you, Mike. So now we have a brief break for lunch. We only have 20 minutes to be able to run down, get our lunch, and bring it back. So we're going to be eating lunch while Lauren is speaking. And Lauren is going to start at 12:45 because we want to have time for discussion. So we'll see you in 20 minutes.